Perfetto, mille grazie.
Ciao. Benissimo, benissimo. Ok, I am Gianluigi Mondaini and I am an architect and teach an architectural engineering degree course at the Marche Polytechnic University, like you said before. Thank you very much for the invitation, and it is a pleasure for me to tell you something about residential architecture in Italy. I am presenting a study that I carried out together with the collaborator and researcher at my university, and probably he has architect Giovanni Rocco Cellini. He is my degree student. And the second slide is the index of my presentation. And as a title of this communication summaries, Rehabilitating the City, Experience and Experimentation for the Quality Living in the City. The aims is to understand how architecture for collective living in Italy has been able to be strategic in designing and building cities. The project I will present constitutes a resonant synthesis of this Italian experience and are also useful for understanding the reasons for contemporary attitudes toward the regeneration of the built environment, especially after the sprawl phenomenon on the 80s. The Italian experience can be summarized in these five moments from the 50 years to the present. First one, new beginnings for a modern Italy. Second, experiments of the modern in Italy. A big science on the ground and failure of ideology and escape from collective living. And finally, is in the contemporary collective living for urban regeneration. In the 1946, just after the Second World War, Italy became a republic. The social and economic problems were many and were aggravated by the destruction caused by the bombing. Like almost all European cities, Italy also had to be rebuilt. These problems also became themes addresses by art and in particular by neorealist cinema, in the order they raise public awareness for a new rebirth. But Italy problems were not only those of the war. There were also serious problems of poverty, and poor hygiene characterized the living condition of many areas, especially in southern Italy, such as Matera, for example. The new Italian Republic had to solve all these problems also through the public housing project, especially for those citizens of rural origin who lived in poverty. Only in this way could the new Italy become a modern country. Until these years, for example, the inhabitants of Matera still lived inside the Sassi. The Sassi were informal dwellings carved into the rock, like caves, on the inhabitants all lived together. Horses and donkeys also lived in the same space, and the rooms were not very well illuminated. However, Matera was like a training ground for the public housing project in Italy. La Martella and Spine Bianche are two of the first public housing settlements that tried to solve this problem of poverty and set up strategies that, in some ways, would be taken up in other later experience. In Matera, in the early 50s, architect Ludovico Quaroni and others designed the build to neighborhood called La Martella. This new settlement was designed to accommodate displaced people, those who had been forced by the state to abandon their homes inside the Sassi in order to improve their quality of life. But the inhabitants of Matera were used to living in caves, and convincing them to leave their homes to go and live in new house was not easy. For this reason, the architect designed a neighborhood that renovated modern canons and simulated the most traditional house form possible, with sloping roof and rural features. The important thing was to adapt the settlement to the orography of the land and to build a centrality for collective activities, such as church and small theater where the communities could gather. Another important experience in Matera was the construction of the Spine Bianche district, coordinated by architect Carlo Aimonino, and with the collaboration of many other architects, including Giancarlo De Carlo. We talk also later by Giancarlo De Carlo. This quarter was also designed to give a new home to people displaced from the Sassi. But this time, the architect opted for an architectural language that was not neorealist, but in any case, capable of adapting to the context of Matera. Again, the project renounced the pure languages of the modern movement, indicating in an Italian way of architectural languages. In Spine Bianche, the various dwellings configure large open and green courtyards where neighborhood relations between the inhabitants can be recreated. For this neighborhood, too, the architects designed a number of collective facilities, such as a church, a square, and commercial space to bring people together. Giancarlo De Carlo's building containing housing and shops played a very important role afterwards. It was strongly attacked by the purist architecture of the modern movement. In my city, in Ancona, in the city of our university, in central of Italy, between 60 and 62, architect Gaetano Minucci designed and built a large collective housing estate named Colle Marino. In this context, the architect designed architecture in accordance with the natural morphology of the land. As in Spine Bianche, the architecture in Colle Marino does not have a totally modern language and expresses itself with some flourishes of local languages. Together with various dwellings, Minucci designed a hearth in the neighborhood with the church and other public and collective spaces. These are important space for bringing the local inhabitants together and offering useful services play a fundamental role. But above all in these years, the reference is always the microcosm of village and small towns, whose dimension is measured by that of men. This Italian way of designing modern architecture was much criticized by the orthodox of the modern movement, those who identified modernity with Le Corbusier's purism. I mentioned earlier that Giancarlo De Carlo's building is Fine Bianche. It's very important. It is, in fact, one of the four buildings that the Italian delegation had presented at the 11th CIAM in Otterlo in 1959, the last CIAM. By presenting this project, the Italian architects were accused of betraying the principles of CIAM and the modern movement. The thesis of the Italian architects and others was that modern architecture should not become a style, that of Le Corbusier, but should become a political and social issue of renewal and relationship with place. In those years, most Italian architects considered modern as a question of renewal and rebuild, without completely forgetting the past. This approach of Italian architecture in that years to exalt rural culture caused what has been described as a historical delay. The most important international references for collective living, in fact, dated back to the 1930s and the 1940s. They were above all the revolutionary ones of Le Corbusier, the rationalist layout of the Ville Radieuse, the potential of reinforced concrete, the realized utopia of a city concentrated in a single building such as the United Habitation, and the possibility of housing multi-ethnic communities in the same building who could personalize their homes as in the Immobile Villa. In order to find the cultural collocation within these references and not to be completely marginalized by international architecture between the 60s and the 70s, some Italian architects approached these models, designing a collective living much more ideological than that the previous years. The most important project in Italy, which meets the criteria of Le Corbusier modern city, is certainly the Olympic Village in Rome. It was designed by Adalberto Libera, Luigi Moretti, and others to host the athletes of the Olympic Games. Was in 60 years in Italy. It was built by the National Institute for the Housing of State Employees. The Olympic Village is located in the north of Rome, near what is new called the Cultural District now, close to Renzo Piano's Auditorium and Zaha Hadid Maxi Museum. The settlement it crossed by a viaduct designed by the most famous engineer in the world, Pierluigi Nervi. at the residence are raised from the ground by a pilotis plane through which it's possible to observe the whole neighborhood. Unfortunately, today, these spaces are full of cars, and not like I imagine you say now. Among the various buildings, Luigi Moretti also designed a square that seemed to embrace people. Inside this, like a picture in the right photograph. Among various buildings, inside the square, like a picture, are numerous collective spaces and public services, especially commercial ones. At the end of the Olympics, Le Corbusier visited the district and he said, "Ah, mais c'est ma ville radieuse, that's just how it is. The pilotis, the big elevated street, only the volumes are different. Too bad. It's the first time I have seen it realized. And then you have a sky and a sun." very good thing about Rome. Luigi Moretti and Adalberto Libera also designed another neighborhood in Rome called Decima, located near the monumental EUR district, denominated EUR, which had become an important business center with office and many buildings of ministries, Italian ministries, realized in the 1960s. These public residences served the workers of this large business center. The architects designed a district very similar to the Olympic Village with the same compositional criteria, referring to the architecture of the modern movement. The large open and green space that connected all the ground floors were very important. The buildings also had a sinuous polygonal open plan layout to create more complex views and enveloping space, especially around the squares and collective open spaces. Another collective living project that refers to the modern movement models in Cecca di Salivoli, near Livorno in Tuscany. The neighborhood was designed to guarantee a community life of high environmental quality for the workers of the Italsider, is very big worker place in Italy, where is iron. The building is made of steel and prefabricated construction system, materials realized in Italsider. The dwellings are again concentrated in a few large volumes, spaced out and surrounded by a large open and natural spaces. A kind of inhabited park with inside residences, car parks, area for sport and children's play, and another activity service to configure a kind of city, but seeking a dialectical relationship with the land and landscape. The third one, big sign on the ground and failure of ideology, the 70s and 80s years. However, in the 70, the collective imagination began to be influenced by the new images and events that moved Italian public housing architecture toward projects of great impact and dimension on the territory. 1969 was a year in which men first landed on the moon, and technological progress led architects to imagine a new forms of self-sufficient moving city, capable and developing and growing without stopping. They imagined mega structure that indistinctly marked the territory, which could be wired and connected to the rest of the world. The imagined architectures that were modular and infinitely repeatable because technology hollowed wit. And it is no surprise that in the early of 1970, the project for collective living looked for affinities with this culture and these utopias. Corviale, designed in Rome by Mario Fiorentino and other architects, including Riccardo Morandi. Riccardo Morandi is the new engineer, very famous, like Pierluigi Nervi. He's the most emblematic example. Another big quartier, another big building realized in Italy in the same years, but in Milan, was Gallaratese. I haven't now the picture, but Gallaratese by Carlo Aimonino is a very famous complex of social housing in Italy, in the north. But Corviale is more representative of this period for his length. It is a building almost 1 kilometer long and 30 meters high, severely making the territory of the Roman suburbs in the middle of the countryside. A long reinforced concrete snake, which he ideally could continue indefinitely, become one big sign. In the architect's idea, this residential building was to build a self-sustaining city. The large residential building is made up of the various living cells that adjoin each other and some common spaces inside. In addition, there are other building volumes and space that were to contain the various public services living. But unfortunately, some of these services were never realized and others were not managed well. The result is that today this large project is in a state of decay and social danger. Having lost the measure of man, the Corviale experiment can be considered a failure. Remaining in Rome, Pietro Barucci designed the Laurentino 38, that quarter, that space are very famous also because was used by many films, many important film of that years. It is a district of collective public housing consisting of a series of buildings connected by a series of bridge to contain collective services, shops, kindergartens, etc. It is a system that is repaired again and again in the design of this part of the Roman suburbs, But many of these bridges have never activated public services, consequently causing a degradation that has forced the administration to demolish some of them because it was completely empty and completely, absolutely dangerous. In this project, as in Corviale, in addition to the large size, the qualitative value of the meeting, the human measure scale, and that character of public centrality recognizable but inhabitants with the squares and social gating space are lost. A peculiarity that characterized the project of the 1950, such as those in Matera, even if they were built in a romantic manner. If those public housing projects were conceived for the formation of community of people, on the other hand, this project referred to an anonymous and generic idea of the masses. Another big sign, we talk about Rome, we talk about Milan, now talk about the south of Italy. Another big sign on Italian territory of public housing is the project by Vittorio Gregotti and Franco Purini and others for the Zen district in Palermo. This project was conceived in the 1970s and continued in construction until the 1990s. The project is conceived as a set of residential blocks called insule, arranged in series and almost all of them equal. Indeed, in the design, the insule arranged in rows are alternated with bands of public services that were never realized. Without collective services, Zen's large size makes the district anonymous and full of unresolved voids. The missing services, which should have structured this part of the city to give it more quality, are sometimes replaced by small informal pavilions. All this has caused degradation and social marginality with very hard problems about the very hard situation in Palermo. I think that you know very well. Then there are some causes of public housing that already renounces collective service useful for building a part of the city at the design stage. This is the case of Gino Valle's residential complex built in the 80s in an old food depot in Giudecca in Venice, a dormitory district from which the inhabitants escape whenever they need some services. From another step, escape from collective dwelling in the 80s and 90s. That was in Italy. What's happened in Italy? From all this design experience, It is clear how the ideology of large size of a city concentrated in the few buildings was in reality a failure. Alt out, Le Corbusier theories on the modern city were revolutionary in character. The examples shown, which are in some ways to product of those ideologies, demonstrate profound fragilities and naivety, not only the functioning or missing of collective service, but also the greed and perverse confidence in a technology that, instead of saving humanity, brought out its weaknesses, consumed resources, brought out non-sustainability, unsustainability, and marginalized people. Going beyond the ideological intent, the architectural legacy in the 1970s it that of an urban reality, especially in the suburbs, consisting of damp, incomplete, unsustainable, and ugly buildings. Buildings that, using the alibi of ideology, in the most cases, in the Italian territories, were designed to buy exclusively speculative operations. The idea of an architecture for a revolutionary city became the architecture to escape from city soon and the architecture to be dismissed. All these caused people to escape from those anonymous and concentrated containers of inhabitants towards new territories that were less dense and more easily modified by the individual. Here, it was possible to have a house built and adapted on one's body, as if it were a tailor-made suite to respond to everyone's different needs. Dwellings that were more tailored to the individual and personalized. But this escape from the collective living caused a new urban phenomenon to explode, the sprawl of the 1980s and 1990s, especially along the two or three territories in Italy, on the Adriatic Sea, along the Adriatic Sea, and also in the valley in the middle from to Venice to Milan. It's just one city realized in that years. Huge quantity of single dwellings or very few units were built, spread across the territories like dust, without the structuring capacity to build real pieces of the city. Moreover, the widespread presence of large infrastructure and communication route made it easier to move between the suburb and the center. The important thing was to possess a car, at least one for each member of the family. The city explosion in the territory that has caused an uncontrolled and irresponsible expansion is, of course, the consequence of consumer society that has renewed its value and priorities. a phenomenon that had already begun in the rest of the world, as shown by Venturi Scott Brown and Eisenhower's critical reading of the American city, who has early 1972 proposed a way of designing learning from Las Vegas. The city, you know perfectly, the city did not need the collective center, but the center was the individual himself, who could move with his personal car indistinctly for many kilometers on the motorway, finding everywhere the same restaurant or the same shopping center and being able to satisfy his every desire. There was no need to design the city, because the city could develop informally and expanded in every direction and without limits, thanks to the car, the infrastructure, and the power of money. At this time, in the 1980s, in the face of this inability to design public housing that would build pieces of city, there are, however, architects who have tried to go against this trend. There are a few of them, but to pick up on what we started at the beginning, Giancarlo De Carlo is one of them. We spoke before about Materan and others question. De Carlo has always been a different architect for the mainstream and against the tide, for the cultural but also political reasons. De Carlo has always been, criticism against the dogmas of the modern movement to the search of an all-Italian way for doing architecture, from the need for a project for develops by trial and error to the centrality assigned to the organization and form and space for society. Giancarlo De Carlo has always understood living as a condition deeply linked to the individual's need to be in a community. Understanding the community as an indispensable value for men and necessary to legitimize the construction of the city. All his design experience demonstrate this, as does the housing estate in Mazzorbo, near the island of Burano in Venice. Here, De Carlo designed a residential settlement that takes up those characterizing and dimension typical of Italian project that are conceived with the dimension of man in mind, the proximity of services and the closeness between parts. Public space that coagulate around the square or around a recognizable and identifying space, such as a courtyard and avenue, etc. These are all aspects that belong to the skyful and the Italian way of buildings of those through public living, as was also the case in the 1950s, immediately after the war. That spoke we before for the our early slides. The House of Mazzorbo, De Carlo's architecture rereads the characteristic of place of their history to reinterpret them in the project. The dwelling in Mazorbo match the architecture of Burano and its colors, but in a more modern and synthetic cave. The housing typologies critically reinterpret the architectural superfetation of building in the Mazorbo, you can see in the drawings in up of the slides, which have grown informally to accommodate workspace, new residents, etc. But in the new dwellings, these spaces are integrated about the project and contribute to configure recognizable urban spaces. Another example from the 1980s, again by architect De Carlo, is the project for the Monte Dago, another residential district in my city, in Ancona, very close to the Howard University. Besides conceiving a settlement in harmony with the natural conformation of the land, the architect introduced a transversal infrastructure of public services into the residential fabric. A series of spaces and buildings with collective function, such as the church, school, civic center, shops, and many open spaces. All arranged in continuity with the various dwellings. The system of collective services would have joined together the fragmentation of the small units and configured a sloping landscape with roofs and terraces integrated into the morphology of the hill. However, contrary to the De Carlo's original plan, today, this system of services has not been realized. Only a few small fragments have been built, incapable of being structuring. The problem is also the same problem with the interpretation of the consummation and interpretation of the modern languages. The services are not realized and realize just a apartment for to realize big quantity of money. The money are the very problem of this period. There are many unfinished void that make the Monte Dago district lose that necessary centrality and multiplicity of services useful to make it a self-sustaining part of the city. Now is the dormitory and not a vitality city like Giancarlo De Carlo think. In any case, this attitude of thinking about public living intimately linked to collective space and services is an all Italian prerogative. Even if it has something filed, the reason is certainly not cultural but economic and administrative problem. It is a cultural root that in different ways continues into the contemporary world. In contrast to the majority of public housing projects in the rest of Europe. In fact, as many international public housing projects demonstrate, with a few exceptions, you obviously, the approach does not aim to build a piece of the city, but the architectural looks primarily at itself. The Italian approach is different. In Italian, in Italy, public living looks for the desire to build a city around a square or a recognizable public space. In Italian, expertise to build the city through public living. In other steps, social housing for urban regeneration, contemporary challenges. Of course, the contemporary world puts in place many other challenges to be followed. The uncontrolled and irresponsible development which characterized the expansion of the late 20th century has left us a heritage to be re-evaluated and reconsidered in the light of new criteria, which have no connection with the ideology, but with the real problems of reality, with those soft futures of contemporaneity no longer incontestable without absolute values and adaptive to the change in the environment and in a society in the transformation processes. The mix of cultures and peoples living together in all the cities of the globalized world and advent of the information technology revolution that has changed people's habits, but also the serious environmental and ecological problems induce the architectural design and therefore also that for public living to a revisioning of paradigms and different sensitivity. But as we shall see, some founding futures of Italian architectural culture continue to be in evidence. One of these to critically observe the architectural experience of history, the greatest book of Italian architecture, From Whose Lessons Architectural and Urban Design Can Always Evolve. Among the many lessons delivered to use by history, one is that the city is built by layers, as demonstrated, for example, by the evolution of the Teatro Marcello in Rome, just to use a very important example, which has changed its original function. Over time, they superimpose new uses on the whole building, in this case is housing. Each layer represents a value, and the layering of this layer delivered to the contemporary society as a multiplicity of values that are a cultural heritage and design method. Contemporary experiments on public living in Italy, in addition to preserving the collective value of architectural space, address to recovery and regeneration of the built environment with the sensitivity that comes from its history. The opportunities for regeneration of the existing heritage through public housing design concern a multiplicity of conditions. In Italy, there are not only monuments, but as we said before, we have also inherited many low quality buildings, most of them built in the 1970s. In this case, in Torino, Studio Costa and Partners, together with Studio Mellano Associati, designed a social housing intervention in one of these containers. Starting from a reading of the state of the building and its structural members, the architects have modified its image by introducing new architectural devices in a new skin. But these interventions are not only aimed to change the visual image, they are actually strategic to improve the environmental and spatial condition of the dwelling inside. The new schemes respond to criteria of sustainability and energy efficiency of the buildings and the balcony devices extending the interior space of the house towards the urban exterior. As social housing, the building is designed to accommodate a plurality of used and collective services, gyms, polyclinics, social services, garden, etc. These services are located inside the building and also characterize the ground floor, which interface directly with the street that became a direct extension of the interior. They are collective spaces that can be used by inhabitants to make community, but they are also services that can be used by all other citizens. Regeneration is not only about the building to be recovered, which by incorporating public housing regenerates the city. Regeneration can also be about the new intervention in particular urban sectors, sector of the city that need to be completed to improve the existing building fabric and those regeneration again. One of these in the Senni di Cambiamento is the Italian name, social housing project in Milan. Here the architect of studio Rossi Prodi Associati have designed a public housing. Development was forms are contextualized which the surrounding residential buildings, denouncing their belonging through tower typology and lower basements that relate to the volumes of the productive and commercial context. In Italy, design the city always means observing the context, studying and reading what happened beyond the administrative boundaries of the city to be built on. And of course, introyecting what is happening outside into the new spatialities, especially the public one. The city enters in the new settlements, configures public space and services, and declares its contemporary through a language adapted to express to the plurality characters of our days. The new neighborhood of public housing is nourished by a collaborative management among the inhabitants who take care of the green areas, of the sharing spaces, and where they can carry out activities that allow them to be as self-sufficient as possible. Another public housing project I want to say also that this experience was particularly important also for technology. This experience is most important also for the technology because there are tall buildings but completely realized in the wood. And also that technology is important to use for a new way to the public building, link the new and sustainable technology. Another public housing project also near Milan is the Sustainable Village of Figino. It is the result of a competition with several equal merit winners contributing to the final realization. The idea is that a building fabric located on the edge of the village of Figino that reconfigures the relationship and the relation with the countryside, introducing greenery inside. But the new settlement also relates with the historic center of Figino in the city of Milan, proposing architectural typologies that establish a dialogue with the context, such as the presence of a tower that not only refers to the vertical construction of the old village, but also create a new visual link with the city of Milano. The new suburbs is composed of several buildings that form courtyards with cuts and views towards the urban and rural landscape. These building blocks contain a plurality of functions and dwellings coexist alongside commercial space, park, open space, etc. In order to respond to social multiplicity and different housing demands, the houses change typology and distribution according to the various users. Many houses also have spaces for work, and especially those on the ground floor face directly onto the street as if they were shops. Similar, many ground floors are equipped with public services that enable the village to activate urban life, flows, moments, and meeting and exchange of society, but also economies. All this takes place in urban space that measure themselves with the human dimension, with the principles of proximity and closeness, and encourage soft and slow mobility against the use of the car. Italy is a country full of villages, small towns, and widespread urban agglomeration, which unfortunately are very vulnerable, mainly because the Italian territory is very seismic. Just last week in our city, there was a very big earthquake, and also my office in the university was closed for 10 days for that question. And it happened that the earthquake arrives that destroyed the part or even whole of the human settlement. This is particular is the case of the reconstruction of a part of San Giuliano di Puglia, which was hit by a violent earthquake in 2002. Fortunately, the damage was limited to a few parts of the town, and the design thinking of architects Femia and Peluffo was to reconstruct public residence by connecting the various parts of the town and evolving the form of tradition that had been violent and quickly erased. He built a new build with contemporary language, but to the historic approach, and linked the sign and the space of the city, and no with the monumental architecture for the I don't you remember the name, the word, sorry, but for the not iconic building, but building look the other closed building. The architect, that's architect, design housing types that respond to the morphology of the land and surviving built fabric. They take advantage to the slopes of the land to accommodate the dwellings on the natural slope of the hill and reinterpret in a more synthetic and abstract way the forms and the languages of the neighboring buildings, but contemporary, like what I say. For example, they design the color in accordance and in harmony with the colors of the context, but they also organize and shape small squares and open space with services for the community. Altaut, not recently on the emblematic project for understanding the Italian sense and method of considered public housing in the city already built, but capable of contributing to its regeneration, is in the Murate district in Florence. It is an intervention that originated from Renzo Piano's guidelines and was that developed by other architects. The pre-existing building is a historical building born in the 15th century as a monastery and then became a prison between the 19th and 20th century. So it has always been a closed complex, segregated and deactivated from public urban life. The new project has set itself the goal and reversing the original sense of these spaces of configuring a kind of upside down through an adaptative reuse of the pre-existence without renouncing the historical and material value of the large built complex and its futures. It before it was a collection of buildings closed on it in on itself. Now the complex becomes porous and the city can flow inside to reactivate the space. Like this picture. But this conversion of meaning introduced adaptation into the architecture that investigated with the sensitivity are able to critically coexist layers and languages of the past with contemporary ones. Architects manifest the difference in value of each period and the recognizability of signs without ambiguity. The coexistence of different languages is also legitimized by the complex new functional mix. No more just one use for one category, like in the modern reinterpretation, but many uses for a plurality of city users. The complex is made up of many volumes that connected with each other, and each of them has been allocated to a different use to meet the multiple needs in the contemporary city. The adaptative reuse of the buildings has made it possible to use existing typological characteristics to accommodate housing types and the coexistence of services, offices, shops, etc. This is another example to reuse an old cinema in Center City and reuse that cinema with new residents. This is a project of new residents, social residents with the services on the ground floor, which was realized in Milan. The design of residence was also an opportunity to formally redevelop this new urban area through a corner solution that not only relates to the street, but also to the open space in the city and in the park nearly. This is another case in Ancona, in our city, where three projects of social housing realized around the plaza. The plaza is the heart of the new buildings. Near the Monte Dago District Design Giancarlo De Carlo, we have seen before, in all these buildings by Danilo Guerri, Roberto Angeloni, and Cherubino Gambardella, I think that you know, all these buildings, in addition to establish a relationship with the circular square, also seek a relationship with the landscape and surrounding hills. Another interesting project in Turin was redevelopment, was also an opportunity to regenerate a small consolidated urban space in the Porta Palazzo in Turin. The pre-existing building is located in the city-built fabric and consists of two abandoned buildings of the balcony type. One of them directly overlook Piazza della Repubblica, which is the large and important market square in the city of Turin. However, beyond its market function, the large space of square is not real collective meeting place for social life, and the social housing intervention was an opportunity to configure a new small open air and less alienating meeting place. The project, which was realized by Fagnoni and Associati, provide for the recovery of the existing buildings, introducing a functional mixité inside, which also includes dwellings, the open courtyard morphologies, defined by assembling the two pre-existing volumes, was an opportunity to distribute various functions and define different way of using the spaces. A central distribution system act as a hinge between the two volumes, one for residents designed for different type of inhabitants, a multi-purpose hall, laundry, and other services for housing, and the other for restaurant and bar and more collective use of the city. The architectural intervention introduced a solar shading system for dwellings to improve energy efficiency. This new scheme, incorporating the balconies, gives a new image to the previously abandoned urban space. But the project is sensitive to the site, the presence of nearby historic market square imposes constraints of the existing building, and the facade on the square has been restored to preserve its original character. And what that was happened now in that piazza arrived life, like in the historic Italian piazza. And now we won't show in the last three or four, I don't remember, probably three slides, our experience in the My University about social housing. This is our experiment of social houses. All buildings are restoration of modern existing building. In the existing building, there was any social items, there aren't services, just a space for car and a very ugly situation. But all buildings we can renovate by a new imaging with new services for the contemporary inhabitants like this. Okay, first example, sorry, eccolo qua. In these cases, the design experimentation tried to change the image of the pre-existing building completely to integrate it better into the surrounding context and to add a basement that can be crossed by urban flows and people, where collective services can be found. In addition to the energy issue, another important aspect was the structural and anti-seismic reinforcement, because all buildings of 70 years are critics for the seismic question. The study of which became the opportunity to shape the space in this new basement. Another case example is a project for the redevelopment of some residential volumes, also in Ancona, with the introduction of a new energy cladding. An attempt was made to change the anonymous image of the pre-existing building, and spatial devices were introduced with the intention of expanding and making the interior space of dwellings more flexible. In addition, a greenhouse was introduced on the roof, which spans the entire length of the building. Devices that are useful to make the building's energy self-sufficient. The intervention hypothesis also includes the regeneration of the ground floors, replacing the garage, which are designed to be located in the basement level with other dwellings and common services in relation to the open spaces of the garden. And in the last one, this is a project in Civitanova Marche. That project are thesis of my course and from me coordinated. The project includes a series of devices. You can see the old building on your left. If you look the ground floor, that ground floor it's completely disactivated from the city. There isn't city in that building because the ground floor is occupied just the cars. The project includes a series of devices that layer the existing volume to densify it and also give it a new imaging. Also, an open and modern space are in that open space. We've included other buildings to densify for use the infrastructure of the city. The main facades are distinguished, which are articulated differently from a formal and material point of view in order to respond to the different energy performances. The north elevation is closed, linear, and interrupted by some projections and excavations. The south elevation, on the other hand, is open, articulated, modular, and characterized by passive energy saving mechanisms. The housing redevelopment project also regenerate the surrounding open space of the city with the presence of some sport facilities. I have finished. Sorry for the run with probably too much slides, but thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Mondaini, for your lecture. It's very interesting to see the evolution about different ideas of collective housing, no? Today we live in very complex contexts. Entonces, from your lecture, we can understand the importance of the architecture recycle. What do you think about the collective housing responsibility in the urban building process?
We have many responsibility on this question. I want to show to the Italian cases because we have many buildings and is important to reuse respect to build because reuse is opportunities for us to save our world, and especially in Italy we have not too much space, and our landscape is important. It's a beautiful landscape also for the aesthetic, but also for the life and for the nature, for the life, and is important not to build other buildings. We have many buildings, especially historical buildings, and it's possible to change, it's possible to use, because many of that buildings are empty, and it's important to use our creativity project a new life for that buildings. And I think that the residents, the social housing is the key for that. Is the social housing is very important key for rebuilt and for new world.
Thank you very much, Prof. Mondaini. ¿Tienen preguntas ustedes que están en línea, Octavio, Juan Carlos, Aranzazú o aquí? Una presentazione molto densa di contenuto, professore.
Grazie, io spero che non vi siate annoiati.
No, con degli esempi anche molto interessanti. Los ejemplos de Giancarlo De Carlo, io personalmente non li conoscevo, tutti questi esempi che lei ha citato, infatti qua c'è una lista molto lunga di progetti. Io conoscevo il progetto del villaggio Matteotti, che penso che sia molto interessante per tutta quella serie di spazi intermedi, ma questo progetto di Mazzorbo penso che lo stesso sia molto interesse.
Sì, sì, diciamo Mazzorbo e Matteotti sono un pochino differenti.
Sì.
Perché nel villaggio Matteotti lui tenta un mix fra il linguaggio moderno e le spazialità italiane. In Mazzorbo tenta di usare la spazialità italiana, ma anche tenta di reinterpretare il linguaggio storico. Quindi sono molto differenti per il linguaggio.
Un architetto complesso.
Molto complesso e ancora molto da studiare.
Bueno, si no hay preguntas, pues despedimos aquí el profesor Gianluigi Mondaini. Muchísimas gracias por haber impartido esta charla. La verdad, la hemos disfrutado muchísimo y nos ha enseñado muchísimos proyectos que deberíamos de empezar, que dovremmo incominciare a estudiar como buenas prácticas de vivienda colectiva. Un abrazo grande, profesor Mondaini, y pues lo mejor.
Grazie, ciao ciao, buona giornata a voi, buon lavoro.
Gracias, hasta luego.
Hasta luego.